Hello students, today we are discussing about one important developmental disorder in children. There are various disorders, especially the developmental disorders in children like ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder, conduct disorder and so on. However, we feel oppositional defiant disorder is most commonly found among many children. So, today let us try to understand the concept of oppositional defiant disorder. What are the symptoms that we see when the child is associated with this kind of a disorder? What are the criteria which can be used in order to diagnose this disorder? And ultimately, let us see the therapeutic procedures involved in dealing with this disorder. So, let us try to understand initially what is this oppositional defiant disorder. Oppositional defiant disorder, in short terms, we can also call it as ODD. It is a childhood disorder that is characterized by negative, defiant, disobedient, and often hostile behavior towards adults and authority figures primarily. So, we see that they are trying to disobey the rules, they are trying to be very negative, not only towards the adults, especially when they are in the authoritative positions. This behavior typically starts by age 8. However, this can also start as early as the preschool years. The characteristic pattern of behaviors in order to claim as oppositional defiant disorder must be different from those of the other children around the same age and developmental level. We cannot say that a child is associated with this oppositional defiant disorder based upon certain problems that were exhibited in their behavior. We have to see whether it is a normal developmental pattern or is it something different or deviating from the existing normal developmental pattern of the behaviors. Only then we can call that a child is affected with this oppositional defiant disorder. And in order to claim that a child is showing the oppositional defiant disorder, the behavior must lead to significant problems in school and also social activities. It is generally found in the research that 10 years after the diagnosis, majority of these children no longer have this disorder. If this disorder persists and worsens, it develops into conduct disorder in adolescence and antisocial personality disorder in adulthood. Oppositional defiant disorder is a commonly diagnosed mental disorder in school-aged children, occurring in between 2 to 16% of the population according to DSM-4-TR. However, the fortunate aspect, or we can say the striking feature of this particular disorder, is there is a treatment which is available, and that is done through the cognitive behavior therapy or family therapy and sometimes through medication. However, there is no evidence to support the use of medication for oppositional defiant disorder. Parent training and training the child in certain skills, especially in enhancing their frustration tolerance levels, being flexible, avoiding emotional reaction have proven to be effective. Once we have understood what is this concept of oppositional defiant disorder, we should also try to understand the causes. Oppositional defiant disorder is a complex problem involving a variety of influences, circumstances, and genetic components. Like any other disorder, we cannot trace to the existence of one particular cause, but an array of factors contribute to this disorder. Contributing causes may be a combination of inherited and environmental factors. These factors include a child's natural disposition. Probably by birth, the child is inherited with a particular personality disposition. Limitations or developmental delays in a child's ability to process thoughts and feelings. Another cause is lack of supervision. When the child is exhibiting some misbehaviors, is there anyone to guide the child's behavior? If the child's behavior is guided, there is a possibility for the child to learn. But if there is no supervision, naturally the child may continue the same pattern of behavior repeatedly, and this may become a habit and ultimately a part of the personality. Another cause is inconsistent or harsh discipline. This is on part of the parents or any other authority figures. Sometimes they are punishing the behavior, sometimes they are ignoring. Naturally, the child will not have the discretion to use which is right and which is wrong behavior. Another cause for this kind of disorder is abuse or neglect. This is once again related to the parental component. If the parents are physically or emotionally abusing the child, or even at the school level, if the teacher is abusing or neglecting the child, naturally, as a resistance factor, the child may show this kind of a negativistic pattern of the behavior. Last but not least, another cause for the development of this disorder is an imbalance of certain brain chemicals such as serotonin. We all know that we cannot underplay the role of neurotransmitters. Similarly, in this case, the serotonin imbalances may lead to the development of this disorder. Apart from these main factors, there are other possible risk factors that may contribute to the development of this disorder. Let us see what are these risk factors. Lack of positive parental involvement. Having parents with a severely troubled marriage. Parents with a history of ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder, or conduct problems. Financial problems in the family, and family instability, which may occur with divorce, multiple moves, or changing schools, or frequent change in the care providers, that is, those who are taking care of the children. All these factors may act as the risk factors. If we just look at the contributing factors and the risk factors, it is highly evident that family, role of the parents, family environment has an adverse impact, or we can say a drastic impact, on the behavior of the child. So, I think to prevent this disorder, the family environment, the parents' role play a vital role. Once we have understood the causes of oppositional defiant disorder, now how to diagnose this? Just because a child is exhibiting some kind of a misbehavior, can we say that the child is showing the negativistic pattern of behavior, the child is showing the defiant behavior? Not necessary. There are certain criteria which we have to follow in order to claim that the child's behavior falls under the category of oppositional defiant disorder. So, let us see what criteria can be used to diagnose this kind of a behavior. Oppositional defiant disorder is defined by the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM-4-TR, as a recurrent pattern of negativistic, defiant, disobedient, and hostile behavior towards authority figures that persists for at least 6 months, and it is not due to a mood or psychotic disorder. Unless certain symptoms are present for about 6 months, and during this period, if the child is not affected with any other kind of a psychotic or mood disorder, only then we can diagnose the child as suffering with oppositional defiant disorder. In order to diagnose the present behavior or the exhibited behavior as oppositional defiant disorder, currently we are using DSM-4-TR. To fulfill the diagnosis, an individual must have at least 4 of the following behavioral characteristics. Let us see what are those characteristics. The child should throw repeated temper tantrums, having frequent outbursts of anger and resentment, argues with adults, especially with those in authority, actively refusing to comply with requests and rules, often deliberately annoys with the others, blames others for his or her mistakes or misbehavior. The child seems very touchy or easily annoyed by others, being spiteful and seeking revenge, being stubborn and unwilling to compromise or negotiate with other children or adults. Among these characteristics, at least four or more than four, if they are seen in the child's behavior, then we have to claim that the child is suffering with oppositional defiant disorder. Negativistic and defiant behaviors are expressed by stubborn resistance to directions, unwilling to compromise, give in or negotiate with adults as well as peers. So, this kind of non-cooperation is highly seen in these children. Defiance may also include deliberate or persistent testing of limits, usually by ignoring orders, arguing, and failing to accept blame for misdeeds. For example, if an ADHD child wantedly pushed someone, he later on feels guilty about it. Whereas a child with oppositional defiant disorder who has done the same kind of a behavior will not accept, will not acknowledge that he has done this behavior. So, there are various relations and also the differences between other developmental disorders and oppositional defiant disorder. Hostility can be directed at adults or peers and is shown by deliberately annoying others or by verbal aggression. However, the aggression in this case is not the physical aggression which we see in the conduct disorder. It is only through the arguments, it is only through non-cooperation, and it is in somewhat reflected as a defiant behavior. Manifestations of this particular disorder are most often present at home environment rather than at the school or community level. Sometimes this is the reason why in the clinical diagnosis the symptoms are not present, or they feel that the child is not suffering with the characteristics of oppositional defiant disorder. Not only this, the symptoms are typically more evident in interactions with adults or peers whom the individual knows well. But whereas with the strangers, they may not be exhibiting this kind of a behavior. Usually, individuals with this disorder do not regard themselves as oppositional or defiant, but justify their behavior as a response to unreasonable demands or circumstances. So, they never acknowledge that their behavior is wrong or that they are behaving rudely or arrogantly towards the others. However, the symptoms of oppositional defiant disorder may be difficult to distinguish from those of other behavioral or mental health problems. Though we are using DSM-4-TR as a criteria to diagnose the presence of oppositional defiant disorder, there are other criteria too. We can say we can take into consideration other indicators, because the research has indicated or the clinicians have proved that there is a high correlation between oppositional defiant disorder and emotional reactivity, hyperactivity and difficulty in soothing before starting school, and with very high or low self-esteem, emotionality, conflict with others, ADHD and learning disorders during school years. There is also a high correlation with disrupted attachment, authoritarian parenting, child neglect, maternal depression and parental discord. In school also, generally the teachers give an impression that these students, that is children who are affected with this oppositional defiant disorder, may show low frustration tolerance in completing assignments, frequent temper tantrums and blaming schoolmates for their own behavior. They may also display other behaviors associated with ADHD, such as short attention span, limited ability to concentrate, restlessness, fidgeting and hyperactivity. Oppositional defiant disorder, generally it is confined only to the children And as the children grow up, the symptoms may disappear with particular treatment. But sometimes this may continue even into the adulthood. Suppose like if an adult is affected or is suffering with this oppositional defiant disorder, an adult may also show the following characteristics: an ongoing pattern of relationship conflict, holding grudges against others, often argues with the boss at work, and this is the reason why ODD adults become self-employed rather than working under someone, blaming others, especially their spouse, for their mistakes, trying to control others. These are the symptoms which we commonly see in adults who have this kind of a disorder, that is oppositional defiant disorder. Oppositional defiant disorder is seen both in boys and girls, but how it is present varies slightly from boys to girls. Naturally, it is a common tendency that boys are more aggressive compared to the girls. Similarly, in this oppositional defiant disorder, based upon that particular trait, we can see the difference. Boys are more likely to display more typical overt characteristics. These behaviors are very obvious, like arguing or fighting. On the other hand, girls tend to display more covert behaviors, including relational aggression and theft. I think you know what is relational aggression. Relational aggression includes behaviors like deliberately destroying friendships, excluding others, and spreading rumors. So these are the slight differences between boys and girls who are affected with this oppositional defiant disorder. Now let us see what is the prevalence and comorbidity levels. Oppositional defiant disorder may be a precursor to other more severe problems such as conduct disorder, substance abuse, and severe delinquency. This is the reason why children with oppositional defiant disorder need to be assessed for the presence of ADHD, learning disorders, as they have high comorbidity. It is also important to diagnose and treat any co-occurring illnesses because they can create or worsen irritability and defiance if left untreated. Roughly half the children with attention deficit or hyperactivity disorder have oppositional defiant disorder too. Many children with oppositional defiant disorder have other treatable conditions like depression, anxiety, learning and communication disorders. We cannot isolate oppositional defiant disorder as only one particular pattern that is seen in the children. They may also have the presence of other disorders. Once we look into the presence of other disorders and if we focus upon the treatment of it, probably the severity of the existing disorder will also be reduced. The prognosis reveals the condition will resolve in most of the children by the time they reach 15 to 16 years. Around 2/3 of children diagnosed with ODD will no longer have significant behavioral problems after 3 years, and about 70% will have no behavioral problems by the age of 18. About 10% of all children with ODD will go on to develop conduct disorder. The earlier a child develops ODD behavior, the more likely it is that the condition will develop into the more dangerous conduct disorder. Children who develop ODD before the age of 10 are at highest risk of developing conduct disorder. The children who develop conduct disorder are at high risk of developing lifelong mental illnesses, including antisocial personality disorder. So, this is about the prognosis of this disorder. There is a high risk that they may develop other behavioral problems if not treated, or when there is no intervention at the appropriate time. Now, can we cure it? Is there any treatment for it? Like any other treatment, it is a combination of psychotherapeutic and medication approaches. However, the research indicates that in treating this particular disorder, there is the use of medication is not really proved to be effective. So, in treating this disorder, the use of medication is confined, or in certain cases, there is no need of medication at all. If we are not using the medication, then what is the treatment approach? How the treatment should be? The treatment mainly includes use of behavioral and other psychological therapies, non-stimulant medications to some extent, and special diets. Generally, the treatment includes addressing all the factors that are present in the existence of the disorder. The treatment can be focused upon at the individual level, at the family level, and specifically at the parental level. So, all these three together can benefit the child and also the family who are adversely affected because of this disorder. So, now let us see what is individual therapy. The individual therapy is generally confined in focusing on the client, that is, in focusing on the child who is exhibiting this behavioral problem. Generally, if we observe the characteristics or the symptoms that are present in this disorder, the child requires most of the life skills. How the child should interact with the others, how the child should improve the communication, how the child should manage the anger levels. Keeping in view all these things, the first importance given in the individual therapy is social skills training. In this social skills training, we try to train the child in enhancing the ability to read the body language and the social cues in their interaction with others. When to continue their conversation, how to control their reactions instead of being overreactive, all these abilities will be enhanced in this social skills training. Another focus would be on anger management skills, because the child is easily getting irritated or annoyed and also reacting emotionally to various situations, either with the adults or with peers. Naturally, the child should know how to manage the anger. So, anger management skills are equally focused upon. Sometimes the stress levels, either at the family level or at the societal level, may also create the problem to the child. So, the child should know how to cope with the situations. So, in the individual therapy, the child would be focused upon learning the skills as to how to cope with the stress or how to manage with the stress. Another important treatment or another important technique that is focused upon in the individual therapy is problem solving skills. Suppose, like, if a child is encountered with a problem and if the child is not able to resolve the problem, naturally that may lead to the frustration, that may lead to the temper tantrums or getting annoyed with the others. But suppose if we teach the child how to manage the problem, how to solve the problem in a more logical and non-aggressive way, probably the child can learn how to cope with the problematic situations. So, problem solving skills are also focused as a part of the individual therapy. Last but not least, in the individual therapy, improving academic skills will also reduce the problems in the school environment. Because most often in the school environment, the child exhibits low frustration tolerance in completing the assignments or in competing with the others. They may not be very flexible. So, if we can improve the academics part, whatever stress the child faces in the situation, that can be reduced and the child's performance may be improved, which may result in a beneficial behaviors too. The second part of the treatment is parent therapy. As we have discussed, parents play a vital role in bringing about the children. Their attitudes, their child-rearing practices, all these things will have an impact on the child's behavior. Unfortunately, we found, like, very authoritarian parents are responsible for the child to develop this kind of a behavior. So naturally, parents also require some kind of a guidance. This parent therapy focuses on making them understand different aspects of the child's development, trying to know how their personality impacts the child. So the parent training can be given in a group setting, and this is often proved to be as effective as family therapy conducted with the parents and the child. Parent therapy is often considered to be the most important part of ODD therapy. So this parent therapy involves various issues. What are those issues? As a part of the therapy, parents are given information about their child's development and needs at different ages. Parents are also taught as to how to establish realistic expectations of their children. Parents must also monitor their children's behavior and develop pro-social behavior in children. Parents must develop rules and limits for their children, and logical consequences have to be explained to the children if these rules are broken. Parents must clearly communicate these rules and limits to their children and must consistently enforce these rules. Sometimes this is where the parents fail. Either they use the harsh discipline or inconsistent discipline in making the children understand what they are communicating. This may lead to the disruptive behavior in children. Parents must spend quality time with their children. Both parents must work together to provide the most consistent parenting. It has been found that parent therapy has significant long-term benefits for both the child and the parents. Naturally, this is quite clear that parents have to be given awareness in bringing about the children, that is, focus on the child rearing practices, what sort of discipline has to be followed, how consistency should be maintained, and how the stability among the parents is very much important in making the child understand a particular punishment or a reward for a behavior. Last but not the least, the therapy that focuses in treating the oppositional defiant disorder is family therapy. Family therapy includes both the individual therapy issues and parent therapy issues. It also focuses on family oriented problem solving skills and communication problems. So family therapy is also found to be very effective therapy for oppositional defiant disorder. Most children with ODD have a difficult time with emotional expression, and so they may benefit from effective education. When they were trained, that is, when the children were trained on how to manage their emotions, how to control their emotions, how to express the emotions appropriately, naturally, this will empower the child to understand their emotional response, and they were also knowing how to verbally express their feelings rather than relying solely on physical outbursts. Most of the time, the children try to get whatever they want by showing the physical temper tantrums, by showing the outbursts. But once they know how to get the things done without showing the temper tantrums, naturally they can improve their self-control. Apart from this education on expression of feelings, children who struggle with emotional regulation also have trouble in controlling their anger. The reason is they may not be knowing how to express their anger. They may not be sensing under what situations they are getting this anger. So naturally, they may overreact to every situation towards anyone, whether it is with adults or whether it is with peers. Therefore, anger management therapy is another useful tool for these children with oppositional defiant disorder. This anger management therapy or anger management techniques include some of the strategies which are taught in this particular session. The strategies mainly include group sessions, or sometimes it can be done at the individual level, which include relaxation, goal setting, problem solving, identifying triggers and recognition of consequences. So, whether the therapy is done at the individual level or the group level, when they try to know how to relax, how to set the goals, how to solve the problem, under what situations they are showing the anger, as a result of the anger, what is the consequence? Once they are aware of these aspects, naturally, the children will know how to manage their own anger levels. So, this will lead to a better self-control of the children. So, individual psychotherapy is another helpful tool for children who cannot maintain control over their behavior. In individual psychotherapy, the children are taught about behavior modification techniques and also communication skills. These techniques will allow them to have a better interaction with the peers, family members, and authority figures. Sometimes, when the child is done individually but not at the group level, they get an opportunity to provide certain insights as to why they are behaving in this particular way, what is the reason for their behavior. So, all these insights can be given to the therapist, which may help the therapist deal with the child in a more effective manner. They may explore personal issues that may be contributing to their defiant behavior.